Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the program, Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Simply take advice to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Do not forget that I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online 24/7, 365 at zenofm.com/Block50. Global Radio. Guys, plenty to get to today. More injuries are happening with the Colorado Buffaloes. The Ryan Day Lou Holtz saga is continuing. The Jets are supposedly signing Trevor Siemian again. The College Football Playoff Committee is hitting a scramble in lieu of Pac-12. They suggest that something needs to be come up with immediately. We're going to be talking about the current top 25 polls, a little bit of did you see this, and more. I really want to get to this College Football Playoff Committee deal because this whole thing is a mad scramble. Obviously, they're talking about a bunch of different scenarios, and they are saying that something needs to be done by this fall because obviously the expansion for next season is set to go. Jim Phillips did an interview with Yahoo Sports. He's the ACC commissioner. He said, we really need to make a decision this fall. We're going to be inside of a year as it relates to the playing season of 2024. I do believe there has to be some reward for a conference champion. That needs to be placed in whatever model we decide, whether it's 6+6, 5+7. Maybe it's the same format that we've agreed upon or talked about before what happened to the Pac-12. Maybe it's the top five conferences or top five ranked teams or the champions of four conferences in the best group of five. End quote. Look, the reality of it is simply this. With the Pac-12 and everything that's going on out there, it has really changed the landscape of the College Football Playoff tremendously. Because if it does dissolve, you can't have just the automatic Power 5, quote, conferences get in. Let's not forget that Oregon State, Washington State blocked a meeting. They got a federal judge to approve this a couple of weeks ago. They blocked a federal meeting where teams were going to meet and vote on whether or not the Pac-12 was going to be able to stay the Pac-12, a conference, period, whether or not it should dissolve. Their whole reasoning behind it was, hey, look, if you're not going to be here, you don't get to vote on this. I agree wholeheartedly. Just to recap, the only teams that are left right now in the Pac-12 as it stands, Stanford, Cal, Oregon State, and Washington State. That's a lot easier than telling you about all the other football teams that have vacated. A 6+6 would simply be conference champions, the highest ranked ones. They automatically get in. And then you would have six, what you would call basically at-large bids. A 5+7 would follow the same concept. Here's the thing, though. You can't, in good logic, really use that anymore, can you? You can't say to yourself that a Big Ten conference champion automatically gets in. Not when it's going to be an oversaturated football conference. You can't even say it about the Big 12. Because obviously Cincinnati made the move over there. But in addition to the other teams that made the move this past season, now you're going to have Colorado, Utah, Arizona, Arizona State. See, this is a big thing that has been going on for college football in a long time because there have been coaching polls that were out there that suggested that they move to just five elite programs or conferences, I should say. Everybody gets voted in. I mean, we're talking about exclusivity here, people. The rich get richer, the poor stay poor, and that's just the way that it'll be. The fact of the matter is, everybody is going to be in it for themselves. Little do they know that it doesn't take long before you're not coach of the wealthy anymore. It could happen to Brian Kelly at any given moment. He could not be the head coach of LSU. Anything could happen, and he can't find a job anywhere that's relevant. Suddenly he starts getting that term over the head. you know, the can't get it done guy. Now he's coaching Utah State, the Sycamores. It's the way that it is. Follow the money, right? It's always been that way, and everybody wants to try and do everything that they can to save themselves. The fact of the matter is college football has gone in a completely different direction. And I know everybody wants to blame the NIL deals, but the fact of the matter is all this is about the college football playoff. There are plenty of coaches out there that will tell you we made a football decision. It's 100% accurate. Do I agree with what is going on in the Pac-12 right now? Look, I don't necessarily agree with all these teams jumping ship. Yeah, I think being on the West Coast and consistently playing football in the Midwest is just not good, okay? And I understand that when athletes are wanting revenue shares, which they deserve regardless of anything, they're getting NIL deals, again, they deserve regardless of anything, more is going to be expected of them. Because more and more, they're going to be treated like professional athletes instead of amateur athletes or student athletes. But they've always been treated like professional athletes. Interviews at ESPN, CBS Sports, whatever the case may be, they've always been treated in that regard. So the simple fact of the matter is, you can't really sit there and say that it's all about the money with NIL deals, because this was all going on long before it. Teams were moving as a way to try and give themselves a better chance at competing for a BCS championship, now a CFP. But it hasn't worked out for West Virginia going to the Big 12, has it? And regional champions really aren't a thing anymore because, let's be honest, not a lot of people have been taking the Pac-12 seriously for a very long time, myself included. The Big 12 hasn't really been taken all that seriously, especially by me. And I catch a lot of hate for it from OU fans, but I really don't give a damn. Your football team hasn't won a championship in over 20 years. Stop telling me, well, at least I was there. You were there and got obliterated by double digits 3 out of the 4 times in the CFP. The only close BCS game you were ever in was against LSU. Other than that, you got annihilated in those games. You got a double-digit loss to Florida. USC, you scored on the opening drive, and that was impressive as it got for you in that game. I don't want to hear it. You probably could have had Josh Heupel as your head coach. Instead, he's at Tennessee. The fact of the matter is the Big 12 hasn't won anything since 2007 when Vince Young basically single-handedly took down the USC Trojans. In fact, you better be thanking Vince Young for that championship, Texas Longhorn fan, because if I remember correctly, weren't they down like 28-0 at halftime to Oklahoma State during that season? Vince Young pops off and takes nobody was open, so he ran it, 60 yards or whatever for that touchdown, completely changed the entire landscape of that football game. This is 110% about nothing more than a college football playoff, and something absolutely needs to be done. The Pac-12 needs to hurry up and vote. They're going to have to hurry up and get schools. They're going to have to hurry up and create schedules. And they're going to have to get schools that are going to give their conference some relevancy. Because if they don't hurry up and do that, they are going to have no choice but to dissolve for football. That's the truth of it. All right, everybody, I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan. If you miss the show live on iTunes, iHeart, Google, etc., wherever you're listening, I am there. Still plenty to get to today. We're going to be talking about more Ryan Day and Lou Holtz. Trevor Siemian back to the Jets. Are the Jets hitting the panic button? The CFP committee, man, I tell you what. Top 25 polls to talk about in college football. A little did you see this? And more injuries with the Colorado Buffaloes. We're going to take a break and pay some of these bills. We'll be back right after this. Don't you dare touch that dial, compadre.
Block 50 Global Radio, the greatest in hip-hop and rap.
A Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the program, Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, wherever you're listening. I am there. Still plenty to get to. We're going to be talking about Shiloh Sanders. Is he having a kidney injury? We're going to be talking about the Jets, Trevor Siemian once again. We still got top 25 polls to discuss in college football. Plenty to get to. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online 24/7, 365 at xenofm.com/Block50 Global Radio. All right, a little bit of, I want to try something new here. Did you see this? This dude, okay, let me set this whole thing up for you, all right? So obviously stand-up comedians have been taking more and more an audience interaction type approach, right? And, you know, obviously, you know, Matt Rife having, you know, a huge thing to do with that, obviously, especially given his time, you know, with Nick Cannon and all those guys. But so Brody saw this, what looked to be a couple in the crowd, made a completely wrong presumption, and then just proceeded to annihilate the situation. Check this out right here. Brody is, he's on one, that's for sure.
Young and in love. Kiss my ass, guys. You're not a couple?
No.
How old are you, if you don't mind me asking? And you know her since you were 27? Hey, guys, do any men in here remember being 27 and being like, you know what, I need female friends? Hey, you know what I can use? A bitch to hang out with. He loves you. Stop doing that.
I swear.
You swear, he don't. Who bought the tickets? Answer this question. Who bought the tickets? Yeah, you did. Yeah, you did. Yeah, you did. Yeah, yeah. This VIP and you ain't giving him nothing? I'm so sick on his behalf. I've had enough of the lies. If you pay for her bill, you're kicked out of the show. I'm telling you that right now.
As a reference for somebody who's like pretending to be
old. Hey, 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 you pay the fuck. He bought the tickets, you pay the whole ass bill. Why are you making fun?
Which, by the way, I left a comment on that thing, all right? And the comment was, you know what? He's enabling her behavior. He knows that she's not interested. Bro, stop being a simp. This is literally the definition of a simp, my man, okay? Just stop it. Of course, you know, if I'm being 100%, we probably all have it wrong. Dude's probably in a relationship already. But then again, the way he proudly said, I paid for the VIP tickets. We got to do better, fellas, okay? We got to stop complaining about, well, she just wants to be my friend. Why? I don't get it, bro. If she doesn't like you, amigo, that's her prerogative. Move the hell on, man. Cut the nonsense already. It's you're literally being the definition of a simp, okay? And anybody in that situation, you know, they know. Like, all right, if he wants to take me out, I'm not going to say no. I mean, some people will, but let's be honest. How many of you, raise your hand, are taking them VIP tickets? Go ahead, I'll wait. And please do not pretend that you will not. 99% of people are going out. Like, you know, it's a free meal. It's free drinks. It's the VIP section of a show. I'm kicking it. Stop it, Brody. But nah, dude was pretty funny, though. I can appreciate him sticking up for the bros, all right? But come on, dude, you got to do better. That's not just a man thing. That's not just a female thing. That's an everybody thing, all right? That is literally an everyone thing. I'm just saying. Check this out. I love this dad joke. Hold up. Well, and actually really quick here, let me set this thing up, all right? So Brody is a skeleton. And he's with this dude at like a Halloween shop or something. And
just, I have a joke for you. What is a skeleton's favorite snack?
I don't know.
Go on, guess.
Death?
No. Go on, guess.
first.
Gas! Gas! Gas, God! Why won't you answer me? What is my favorite snack?
Bones.
No! No! What is it? Why must you fail me so often? Ribs! Spare ribs!
What is a skeleton's favorite snack? Spare ribs. He just kept like getting dude's face with that skeleton. Oh man, that is fantastic. Oh my goodness. Now tell me if you've seen this. This dude is hilarious. Stephen He, oh my gosh. He's this Asian dude, man. And between him and Uncle Roger, I don't know which one is funnier, but man alive, what do you hear this?
Stephen, how the test result go?
I got an A in English.
Okay.
We take an M
and an A in science.
No problem.
And I got a B in math.
Sorry, I didn't hear properly.
What you say?
I actually got a B in math.
Honey, calm down now. You don't believe what Stephen said. He said we got B in math.
We...
He's Asian, Uncle Roger. You don't believe what Stephen said? He said he's no good at math.
I don't get it. I can't just like activate Asian power. It doesn't work like that. Because you're stupid. 10x squared plus 2x equal 9. Solve for x. So you move x to the other side and you
okay, you order 10 bowls of rice squared plus 2 bowls. You have 9 left over. How much rice did you eat?
17 and a half bowls. Why are you asking me that?
5 friends want bubble tea squared. 9 friends want bubble tea. 1 left over for yourself. How many you buy?
11 bubble teas for $65.33 here at VB's. But if you go to the city, you'll have to add 3% value added tax. That'll be up to $69.90.
Oh my god! I could have done this all this time!
Told you that, stupid.
Stupid. Talk about childhood trauma. Ribs. Spare ribs. Oh, my ribs hurt. My ribs are hurting. Why do I have this childish ass laugh? I got a voice of a 6'10" dude and the laugh of an 8-year-old. Oh my gosh, bro. Oh man. One of my all-time favorite dad jokes is what happens to a frog's car when it dies? It gets towed. You know why? You know why it died, don't you? It croaked. Or what sound does leather make when it sneezes? A shoe. All right, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. Still plenty to get to. We got Ryan Day and Lou Holtz and their whole nonsense. The Jets are reportedly signing Trevor Siemian. Don't know why, bro. We still got top 25 in college football to talk about. Don't forget, I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Block 50 Global Radio. So is TikTok. We've got to take a break right quick, man. We got some of these bills that we got to pay. You know how it is around here. My name is Drew Duncan. We'll be back right after this. Don't you dare touch that dial.
Block 50 Global Radio.
I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the show Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Still plenty to get to today. We're going to be talking about Trevor Siemian signing with the Jets. We've got top 25 college football to talk about. Shiloh Sanders supposedly was urinating blood from a hit to the kidneys. We're going to be discussing that as well with the Colorado Buffaloes, where the injuries are starting to mount with Deion Sanders' crew, aren't they? Obviously, Travis Hunter, now potentially Shiloh Sanders. It's getting thick. I'm going to tell you what, man, that Colorado State game, I think, really took a toll on that football team. I mean, really took a toll. We're going to be talking about it a little bit later on. But in the meantime, the Jets are reportedly signing Trevor Siemian again. Of course, last time he was with the Jets, kind of an unenthusiastic, 2017, somewhere in that neighborhood. Time that was there, he got injured. Ended up snapping away. I tell you what, if you saw that injury, when it just, the way he landed on that thing, it was gruesome, to say the least. Look, as a long-life Broncos fan, I can tell you right now, there's only one thing to do with Trevor Siemian. If they're going to bring him in, you have to use him in a very specific way. I don't know how many people actually watched him play football at Northwestern. And I was so traumatized by all this that I still practically have my old original spiel memorized from the last time that Trevor Siemian was there. And from the time that he was at Denver. Because it was such a horrendous time. It was directly pretty much after Peyton Manning and couldn't find a quarterback. And I couldn't believe Denver drafted Trevor Siemian. I was just like, really, bro? And then I thought, well, maybe they're going to, kind of modernize the offense a little bit, kind of old school power sets with the new school way of doing it out of the pistol, two tight ends, run some of those option plays, rollouts, right? You rely on the mid-game. Once in a while, you take a shot down deep, but you're all about ball control, slowing everything down. You're going to rely on your defense to play really good football, and you're just going to use like a mid-range pass game, 5 to 15 yards, nothing spectacular. You're going to let guys catch and get that yak. You're going to pound the football right up the middle on them. You're going to run some RPOs, some straight-up option plays. I'm talking about speed option plays. Old school. New York's not going to do that. New York doesn't even know what the hell they're doing with the three running backs they got right now. Breece Hall has played outstanding. Dalvin Cook's been pretty good. And now you've got guys arguing with running backs coaches and running backs not being able to block and everything else that's going on right now with the New York Jets. It's actually pretty horrific right now what's in New York. I mean, I don't know who's in a worse situation. Me personally, I think the Jets put themselves in that situation by signing Aaron Rodgers, by signing Nathaniel Hackett, because Nathaniel Hackett's only got one way of doing things, okay? Let's be honest. Last year, there was a game where Denver was in Europe. They started to run like a very hurry-up style of offense. Okay, and when they went no huddle, they looked fantastic. Nathaniel Hackett just, nah, why are we going to do something that works? Why, bro? Can anybody explain to me the reason why I'm going to do something that works? Don't you know I'm Nathaniel Hackett? I know everything. My way is the right way. Don't you know that? I'm Nathaniel Hackett. That's exactly what I feel like that dude is like. And I get people wanting to point the finger at somebody, and usually it's the quarterback, but it's just not on Zach Wilson. It's pitiful coaching from Nathaniel Hackett. It's an offensive line that couldn't block a D2 football team. And why in the absolute hell is Trevor Siemian still employed in the NFL? Can anybody explain that to me? What has he ever done? I think the last time he was with the Jets, 59% completion percentage. You're not getting any better with Trevor Siemian. And are you going to start him over Zach Wilson? At least Wilson can take the hits back there. At least Wilson is built to take the bumps. I have said a million times, and I said it going into the season. I said it before the first game of the year. I've said it afterwards. I've said it a couple of days ago. I said it on Monday. I said it on Tuesday, and I'm going to have to say it again today on Wednesday. Or tomorrow on Wednesday. Whatever, man. These days are blending. The fact of the matter is simply this. It is Wednesday. Good grief. If you guys knew how much sleep I got every night, about 3 or 4 hours. The fact of the matter is this. Okay? The Jets' offensive line in Nathaniel Hackett's coaching is a match made in hell. It is horrendous. You can't expect anybody to be behind that O-line. And I said it, and I said it, and I said it. Aaron Rodgers is about to know what it's like to be Zach Wilson. How many times do I have to get on this microphone and explain to people that nobody could quarterback that football team? Not Mike Vick, not John Elway, not Aaron Rodgers. Nobody could. They're awful. Joe Montana, Dan Marino, you stick anybody behind that offensive line, and they will utterly fail. I don't give a damn who it is. Nobody's built to be behind that offensive line. How Zach Wilson is walking around town like everything is fine with no injuries or anything is beyond me. He must be made of steel. And you know what they're telling him. They're telling him not to scramble and get yardage. They're telling him to sit back in that pocket and just be a quarterback. You know that's what they're doing. Last year, at least he was allowed to make plays. If I'm Zach Wilson, and I'm damn serious, if I'm Zach Wilson and I get another chance to play one snap, I don't give a damn what Nathaniel Hackett calls. Whoever is in that backfield, I am telling him we're going to run it down their throats. And every time he calls a stupid-ass pass play where all I do is drop back and hope like hell my offensive line is going to protect me for longer than 1.3 seconds, I'm going to change it to either a run play or a rollout on play action. And I'm just going to go old school football. And every time I run over to that sideline and Nathaniel Hackett has got something to say to me, I'm going to tell him, I'm sorry, bro, I can't hear you right now. Oh, it's just really loud in the stadium, man. Oh, okay, yeah, I'll button up. All right, and then I'm going back out there and I'm doing the exact same damn thing again. You know why? Because I know that that's how we're going to score. I know that that's our best chance to win football games. I'm not saying Zach Wilson is elite. He's not. But look what happened to Aaron Rodgers. He played 4 plays in that football game. And in every single play, he was under pressure. Nathaniel Hackett's system will not work with that offensive line. He wants everything deep down the seam. He wants look-off plays, these plays that take 3 to 4 seconds to develop. And he thinks that the quarterback doing the look-offs are going to matter when you have an offensive line that couldn't block a D2 football team. I know some high school defensive lines that could probably get over on them. Are you kidding me right now? They could have the best running game in all the NFL. The run blocking isn't the problem. The running backs are superb. That's not the issue with New York. The issue is a ridiculous coach who just won't bend. Okay, bro, fine. Protect your boy Aaron Rodgers, because that's what he's doing. He's making sure that Rodgers looks good, so that way they can bring him back next year. Oh, see, yeah, if we had Aaron Rodgers, we'd be good. No, you wouldn't. And I don't give a damn what Aaron Rodgers says. I'm not saying we'd be 3-0. We could be. No, you wouldn't be. Not behind that offensive line. Everybody would still be laughing at the Jets this season. I'm just saying. Everybody, I'm Drew Duncan. This is Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is at Drew Duncan Radio. We're going to take a break. Don't you dare touch that dial.
Block 50 Global Radio, the greatest in hip-hop and rap.
Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the program Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer. If you miss a show live, I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Still plenty to get to in today's program. The injuries are beginning to mount for Deion Sanders and company. We still got Ryan Day and Lou Holtz to discuss. Plenty to get to. In the meantime, do not forget that I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online 24/7, 365 at zenofm.com/Block50 Global Radio. And of course, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram and TikTok is all at Block 50 Global Radio. I want to get into the top 25 polls, because it used to be for me that I really wanted the polls to wait to come out until week number 4. And mind you, the coaches poll is still the one that matters the most. I don't know if people understand this concept or not. They just greatly consider the winner of the college football playoff. All right. It's basically a tournament, guys. It's an invite tournament, especially with it expanding to 12 teams. It's literally a tournament invite. And the coaches still vote on who the national champion is. It's been like that in college football forever. I don't think it's really going to change. In the meantime, though, Georgia is still sitting at number 1. You've got Michigan at number 2. Texas at number 3. Ohio State. Florida State. They pull out the top 5 there. Followed by Penn State, Washington, USC, Oregon, Utah. By the way, in case you're wondering or don't know, yes, Colorado has officially dropped out of the top 25. So they no longer exist. OU's only sitting at 14. North Carolina at 15. By the way, Oregon State at number 19. In fact, there's a lot of Pac-12 teams. One team, there's teams, though, that I just know that don't belong there. Number 1 is going to be Kansas. There's no convincing me. All right? And we saw this last year with KU. Started out 6-0, and then from there, 6 losses in a row. I'm not sold. I'm not with it. They're still going to have to be in the Big 12. They have not played anybody of significance whatsoever. But here's the thing, though, guys. I think it was after week 3, in Division I college football, there were only 39 undefeated teams that were left. You have to really consider that. The transfer portal Dion really? Dion came in, and you do not understand the Dion effect in college football. He messed everything up, and these coaches know it. Don't tell me they're not ticked off. They are. I said it before, Keyshawn Johnson. They want to stop him from that system. We're going to get into that a little bit later on, but regardless, you know, I just, at this point in the season, what are you going to do with the top 25? I mean, Georgia's the defending national champion, and until somebody beats them, regardless of how good or bad they look, yeah, what are you going to do? Michigan hasn't done anything of significance. Texas, you could say their win over Alabama, but Alabama just looks completely confused right now. They're number 12 for a reason. You know, I mean, the quarterback last weekend, quarterback this weekend, who the hell really knows? You know, I don't know what Nick Saban is trying to accomplish with all this right now, but to me, it's not sending a good message. It's really not. And regardless of what you think of Deion Sanders, people, I got news for you. These kids are watching what's happening right now in Alabama, and they're going, that coach wants me to play paranoid. Meanwhile, in Colorado, what's going on out there is, hey, man, you're going to sit out. You're going to wait till you're actually ready and rested and healed. I know you want to be out there, but you have a bigger future ahead of you. This is bigger than football. I want you to be taken care of. Huge difference, folks. You don't think they're not seeing that go down? You think these kids are so stupid? You got another thing coming. Honestly, if I had to pick a number one team right now in college football, I would probably go Texas just because of their win over Alabama. It doesn't seem like it's going to be that big of a deal come the end of the season. But right now, to me, that win is the strongest win of anybody except for Ohio State over Notre Dame. And Ohio State, I still would not put them in the top five. I really wouldn't. Notre Dame shot themselves in the foot. You know, Marcus Freeman didn't want to rush, you know, another guy on there, and that's all fine and dandy. But I would probably have Ohio State somewhere like number 10, number 9. And I know you Buckeyes fans love to go, yep, that's it, keep hating on us. I mean, you like to pretend that you're a victim, and you like to pretend that, you know, you don't get any favoritism, but you do. You jump from number 6 to number 3. I justified it. We all justified it. The national championship that they won justified it. The initial CFP. Stop pretending like people are not on your side, because those who matter the most are. I just really need you to calm down. Kyle McCord was against a defense that was not as an opportunistic defense as they should have been in that game. I hate using the term lucky. It almost came out of my mouth. Don't make me say it on this show. Okay? Don't make me break my own damn rules. Don't make me do that. Just chill out and accept the fact that you're going to have to win a Big Ten championship. You're going to have to get by Michigan, which, from looking at it right now and the mess that's going on with Jim Harbaugh and how mid they've been, offensively, they are not good. Defensively, we'll see, but offensively, not it at all. No. Ohio State may luck out this year. Not so much next year when that conference really beefs up, but this year, yes. Which obviously we're going to be talking about Ohio State and Lou Holtz a little bit later on, but I would honestly right now, I would take Penn State over Ohio State. Look, Penn State's offense isn't really that good, but I think they have a better defense, if I'm being honest with you. That's probably going to be a low-scoring game. I mean, you know, when two defenses get together like that are really good, I mean, one of two things usually happens, right? You have either a really low-scoring, grinded-out football game, or for some reason both teams explode and they put up over 40 on each other. It's the damnedest thing. I think Florida State's good at number 5 right now. Given what we've seen from LSU, I think it's good. I'm right there with Oklahoma. Honestly, I'd probably put them a little bit lower than 14. I'd probably have them sitting at 20. they played absolutely nobody in their out-of-conference schedule. And then when they played Cincinnati, they weren't really all that impressive in that football game. I've talked about it before. You know, these teams, they play nobody university, and then, you know, they get into conference play. And I mean, think about it. This is – Cincinnati's not adapt to the Big 12, right? They're not. So you play a team that's above average, that's the end result. I'm betting the Texas OU game – early in the year is probably going to end up deciding the Big 12, if I'm being honest with you. Because the Big 12 is just not strong at all this season. And Texas, honestly, given what I've seen from OU, there's no reason why they shouldn't win that game by a couple touchdowns, if I'm being honest. I like UNC sitting at about number 15 right now. They've got so much better on defense, but offensively, I don't know. Obviously, you know, Duke out there in the ACC right now. See how that goes. Clemson really just had so many chances to beat Florida State and couldn't get it done. So, you know, we'll see what happens with that. Florida, I think, is sitting right at 22. I like Missouri at 23. That's okay. Fresno State crept in at number 25. We'll see how that works out. Pac-12 might want to take notice. All right, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Still got plenty to get to today. We're going to be talking about Ryan Day and the Lou Holtz saga continuing with Notre Dame and Ohio State. Shiloh Sanders looks like he's going to be out with a kidney injury. We'll be back after this. Don't you dare touch that dial.
Block 50 Global Radio, the greatest in hip-hop and rap.
Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on Block 50 Global Radio. Thank you for tuning in. Do not forget that Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Block 50 Global Radio. And, of course, they are wherever you are listening to podcasts. I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan. TikTok and YouTube is the real Drew Duncan. And I also am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Plenty more to get to. We're going to be back right after this quick commercial break. Don't you dare touch that dial.
Block 50 Global Radio, the greatest in hip-hop and rap.
Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the program Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. If you miss the show live, just check out the podcast, man. It's 2023. Everybody's got one. You know what I mean? I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio's online, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, TikTok, all at Block 50 Global Radio. Still plenty to get to. A little bit later, we're going to be talking about Shiloh Sanders, potentially a kidney injury. Reports are suggesting that he was urinating blood, taken to a hospital. We'll get to that as well. Dion and company really taking on some hits right now in the last couple of weeks. In the meantime, Lou Holtz. You remember what happened with Lou Holtz, don't you? Lou Holtz on Saturday on College Game Day went and said that Marcus Freeman is a better head coach. He believed that Notre Dame had a better offensive and defensive line. I felt the same way. I had talked about that going into the weekend. I also felt that Marcus Freeman was a better head coach than Ryan Day. Let's not forget, people, that Lou Holtz is like 90 years old, by the way. Lou Holtz was having a conversation with Lou Holtz, and the guy who did a Lou Holtz impersonation, by the way, was pretty damn good. He was spot on. And see, the thing was, is Lou was very cool about that. As a matter of fact, Lou was very cool. Yeah, because some people have a cool personality, man. Lou Holtz has recently said in response to Ryan Day, because as you remember, Ryan Day went off like a 5-minute tangent about where's Lou Holtz? Where's Lou Holtz? Where's Lou Holtz? Did you, first of all, how did he even have time to watch College Game Day? Weren't you getting your team ready for a football game? All right. Secondly, he's like 90, so let's chill the hell out. Like, what are you going to do, bro? Are you going to fight Lou Holtz? Is that what you're going to do? You're going to fight Lou Holtz? You're going to go looking for Lou Holtz somewhere in the yard? You're going to show up at his crib? Are you going to dare him to come to your practice? Ryan Day wouldn't talk to Lou Holtz like that to his face. It would not happen. Let's get that clear right now. That's why everybody thinks he's being a big baby. Because it's like, dude, he's an elderly person. He's earned the right to say whatever the hell he wants to. He's lived his life. He's won his national championships. He was a hell of a coach at Notre Dame. He turned around South Carolina for a couple of seasons. Let's not forget about that. Let's not forget how much those players loved him at South Carolina. Okay? Lou Holtz, if anybody has earned the right, come on, man. I used to love watching his pregame speeches when he was a part of ESPN. My favorite one was, ABC's not paying us to keep this game close. Let's go out there and kick their ass. Just dominate. You're damn right. By the way, he said that about Syracuse getting ready to play Notre Dame in a game that Syracuse was highly underdogged. In the meantime, Lou Holtz said, well, that's his choice, talking about Ryan Day calling him out. And I can understand why he did. He doesn't want to talk about Michigan and 0-2. He doesn't want to talk about the big game coming up against Penn State and against Michigan again. He's a great coach. He's done a tremendous job. He's a great offensive mind. He just started going in. But then he again stated that he thought that, you know, Notre Dame was better. But here's the main thing about Lou. This is what you got to love about Lou Holtz. A direct quote from him. I called Coach Freeman on Monday and apologized because I put him in a bad position, maybe. I don't feel bad about saying it because I believed it. And Notre Dame was the better football team. Three times Ohio State had 4th-and-1, ran the ball, and couldn't make it. Other than the one big long run, they averaged less than 2 yards a carry. But if I was coaching, I would have said it. And I would have went to our team and said, I think you're better. I think you're more physical. I think you're more talented. He apologized to Marcus Freeman. He felt that he put him in a bad situation. He felt that he put him in a bad situation by maybe riling up Ohio State, riling up Ryan Day, by maybe talking out of order, by maybe speaking out of order. Poor Lou Holtz. Dude, Ryan Day is a chump, man. Hey, Ohio State fan, are you going to justify him talking about a 90-year-old person this way? I've been a huge fan of the Ohio State Buckeyes for a long time, and I have always rooted for them in Michigan in that football game. always, and I mean always, Eddie George, absolutely. He made me a big-time Ohio State football fan. I loved watching him play football. Maurice Claret, one of my favorite running backs, again, in college football history. I'm going to tell you this. If you think that this is okay, if you generally believe that this is all right, what Ryan Day has done, by being a big baby, acting like he's going to beat up a 90-year-old man or something, then honestly, you can kiss my 995, amigo. How in the hell can you justify all of this? Ryan Day's tangent was the most childish act I think I've ever seen from a head football coach. There are literally people out there worried about Deion Sanders wearing a hat and sunglasses, talking to the youth as on their level, still rocking gold chains, still being confident, a little bit of cocky in there. You're worried about that when Ryan Day is out here yelling at Lou Holtz, I want to know where Lou Holtz is. What are you going to do, man? Huh? Well, you can always tell when somebody's mama ain't really raised them right. I mean, since Norvell want to speak on it, and I really don't give a damn if I've made an enemy out of Ryan Day. And to be honest with you, I really don't give a damn if Ryan Day comes for me. At least I'm 40. Well, I will be in November. At least I'm of appropriate age to do so. You know, because of Deion, now all of a sudden, all these coaches want to get on TV and get riled up and pretend that they've got some sort of vengeful mark that they... What do you all think you are now? The Avengers? Huh? Y'all think you're comic book characters with the world against you and we're all going to together and unite? You just find whatever nonsense you can. You think you're Michael Jordan? Is that it? I really want to know the answer to these questions. Because I got news for everybody. Prime and them haven't attacked nobody. Yeah, those kids were on the Oregon logo. I'll give you that. But before that, name an instance. Because they weren't the ones who started it when Colorado State was meeting up with them on midfield. And Colorado State's coaches were out there jawing with those 18 and 19-year-old kids. 35, 40-year-old men out there jawing with 18 and 19-year-olds. On a logo. That is what you're telling me is the, like, that's okay, right? That's perfectly fine. Hey, Ryan Day, you want to run your mouth about somebody? Why don't you come run it about me? Because Lou Holtz is 90. Stop pretending that you're going to see Lou Holtz in the yard. Where's Lou Holtz? Stop pretending that, like, you and Lou have a beef now. Because of what you did, Lou Holtz somewhat felt guilty for this, called Marcus Freeman, said, hey, this is my fault. I think I may have brought this on you. I'm so sorry. How do you feel, bro, knowing that you made a 90-year-old elderly person feel that way? Who's earned the absolute right to say whatever the hell it is they want to say at their age. He's won his championship. Let it ride, bro. It's frustrating. Guys, I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. We still got Deion Sanders and the Buffaloes to talk about. Tell you what we're not going to talk about is Taylor Swift and Travis Kelce. I know that. We'll be back.
Block 50 Global Radio, the greatest in hip-hop and rap.
everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the program, Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan, iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Still plenty to get to in the show today. Obviously, we're getting ready to talk about the Buffs. By the way, I'm not backing down from what I just said about Ryan Day. In case anybody's questioning that, you so tough behind that microphone. How tough was he in that press conference without Lou Holtz around? Please. Like, he would talk to Lou Holtz like that face to face. Are you kidding me? You're so tough, bro. I want to know where Lou Holtz is. Probably at home taking a nap. He's 90. That's what Lou Holtz is doing. That's where he is. He's at home taking a grandpa nap. Eating something really greasy and drinking a soda pop. I'm just saying. Where's Lou Holtz? Your mamas? All right, Colorado, the Buffaloes. Boy, I tell you what, the injuries are mounting for the Buffs, mounting incredibly. And I don't know that it's going to get any better for them against USC. I mean, I'm just being honest at this point. I love primetime. I love what he is doing at the University of Colorado. I really do. But Shiloh Sanders was taken to a hospital. And by the way, this is per the Buffs beat. So the beat writers for Colorado. Excuse me. That's directly where this is coming from. That little Italian sub will get the better of you. Don't talk to me about what time it is, by the way. I don't care. I'm going to take a walk in a little bit anyway. And for the record, I've lost 25 pounds. Thank you very much. By the way, Sanders in the last game, he had 7 tackles. But man, I got to tell you, I don't know that it's getting any better. The report is that even though Deion didn't mention anything about it post-conference, I guess nobody really knew until they got on the plane. Shiloh started noticing some symptoms. I guess he ended up having blood in his urine. And was taken out for possible kidney, like a suspected hit to the kidney. They took him for further evaluation. At this moment, they really don't know anything more. I guess as soon as Sanders was walking off the team plane, that's when they decided, dude, you're going to have to go to the hospital. You know, Deion right now is in a real jam. He's in a real jam. Shiloh Sanders, if you remember correctly, had that interception returned for a touchdown against Colorado State. He's actually created a bunch of turnovers. In fact, the Colorado Buffaloes, I believe, are still number one in college football in creating turnovers because they did force an interception with Bo Nix. So, you know, through 4 games, they've created 11 turnovers on the season. They are one of the best in all of college football at doing this. I mean, you have a cornerback's coach and your head coach is a guy who is one of the best all-time cornerbacks ever in the NFL. I mean, it should be that way, right? I don't know why everybody acts so surprised about it. I guess we forget Deion Sanders is Deion Sanders. Like, he didn't play football in the NFL for a long period of time. Like, even after leaving football, the Ravens still wanted him no matter what. That's how good Deion was. It didn't matter. The thing about it is, I'm with Keyshawn Johnson, and I said it before Keyshawn Johnson did, and I talked about it, that Colorado State game being a message to Deion Sanders and his crew. The fact that the AD for Colorado State supported what happened in that football game really should be telling everybody everything that they need to know. And I don't want to hear it's football, man, it's football. The hit on Travis Hunter wasn't that bad. Really, lacerations? You know, you could die from lacerations. Did you know that? But that's football, though, bro, right? It's football when somebody comes over they purposely mind their steps. They're not watching the football at all. And then not only do they duck their own guy and make their way around him because the pass has been covered. It's clearly good defense on the part of Colorado State. Puts himself in position, works his way around him, and then just poof, puts it down. And then you could see the way he was walking over looking at his coach. That was coached. How did, if you don't think that this is obvious what they want to do to Deion, come on, man. Dan Lanning, I hope the whole country's watching. You don't think they're not trying to shut him down for what he's doing out there in Colorado? You know, one of the things that I talked about earlier was, think about it like this. Nick Saban, which, by the way, he is the GOAT right now in college football. There's no disputing that. Nick Saban is very literally documented as saying, I like my players to play with a little paranoia. I like them to know that somebody else can easily replace them. Let's not forget what happened with Tua and Jalen Hurts. That was kind of the beginning of it all. Let's not forget Nick Saban. Hey, man, each one of them knows what they got to do. They're going to do what's best for the team. That's all there is to it. Remember that? Nobody? I guess we're all going to pretend like we don't remember that whole thing going down. Now he doesn't know who his quarterback is. He's telling people, I want them to play paranoid. Deion Sanders, he's out there and he's like, hey, Travis, don't worry about getting back to the team right now. We love you. We miss you. We need you. But your future is more important. You need to get healthy. You need to get better. Man, I love you. See the real big difference right there, guys? You don't think coaches aren't seeing this go down? And they're going, damn, all I've done has been seen on television yelling at my guys. Brian Kelly, when he was at Notre Dame, his exact words were, I'm in favor of execution. Maybe our guys needed to be executed after tonight. By the way, that was after they won the football game. Think about that for just a moment. That interview with Brian Kelly is in full circulation after that game. Brian Kelly's out there going, hey, man, we got to be careful with the money that's circulating. You don't think these college kids aren't watching this go down? You don't think they don't see what's happening here? You don't think these high school kids that are recruits right now aren't seeing this all go down? You got Deion talking to everybody else's players, chatting them up, being good with them. Remember the whole thing at TCU when they played that first game? Hey, man, come on, get up. Without you, they ain't got a chance. Hugging other teams' players, I love you. You're playing great. Hey, if you want to hit the transfer portal, you know how to find me. Come on now. You don't think that these coaches aren't scared? You don't think there wasn't a hit out on that Colorado Buffaloes team against Colorado State? It is happening, people. Whether you like it or not, you can call me conspiracy theorist all you want to. I take the point of a stand-up comedian. I probably should look up his name right now, but it would be too damn difficult live on the radio. But he basically said, you don't believe in any conspiracy theories? Because I'm not a big one. But he goes, look, I've got one son. I lie to that little dude all the time. And you think the U.S. government is batting 1,000? You think these coaches and fraternities and all these people out here talking about Deion Sanders are batting 1,000 with them? How much they love Deion? Pfft. Boy, you've got another thing coming. They don't want him coming in and disrupting the status quo. you better get a mental check. You better go back and rewatch that game against Colorado State. And you better rewatch that game with Oregon. And you better listen closely to what Dan Lanning is talking about. Guys, I am Drew Duncan, brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. The show's fired up. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. We'll be back. Don't you dare touch that dial.
Block 50 Global Radio, the greatest in hip-hop and rap.
Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on Block 50 Global Radio. Thank you for tuning in. Do not forget that Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Block 50 Global Radio. And, of course, they are wherever you are listening to podcasts. I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan. TikTok and YouTube is the real Drew Duncan. And I also am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Plenty more to get to. We're going to be back right after this quick commercial break. Don't you dare touch that dial.
Block 50 Global Radio.
Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the program Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online 24/7, 365 at zenofm.com/Block50 Global Radio. Still plenty to get to in the program. A little bit later on, we're going to be talking Dwight Howard. In the meantime, Nate Diaz. Well, there's that. The Chargers are going to get dropped from a brawl that happened in Bourbon Street down in Louisiana. In fact, I'm going to read you a direct quote here coming from... Boy, I tell you what, I mean, this was a DA thing right here. Since Rodney Peterson sought out to fight Nate on Bourbon Street, we have maintained Nate's actions were 100% in self-defense. It was clear in the video, clear in pictures, and clear from multiple other videos Rodney posted before and after. Nate has a right to defend himself against those who want to make a name for themselves and did so. We appreciate the New Orleans Parish District Attorney taking the time to review all aspects of this case and their decision not to proceed with it. Anybody who knows me knows I can't stand Nate Diaz. I think he's a troll sometimes. I think he's a closet McGregor fan. Everything McGregor's ever done, Nate Diaz is like, oh, I'm going to do that too. McGregor's going to box? I'm going to box. McGregor's going to do this? I'm going to do that. McGregor's going to retire. I'm retired. Can't stand him. However, see, and Skip Bayless and Stephen A., I hope everybody else is listening to this. This is where impartial journalism comes into play. Because I'm going to tell you something, my man. If you run up on somebody, for anybody who saw that video, when you run up on somebody, especially an MMA fighter, you will deal with the consequences. That's all there is to it. See, my generation, the saying was, don't start none, won't be none. And whether you knew who Nate Diaz was or not, the reality of it is, man, you never know who you're rolling up on. And you might catch a two-piece with a biscuit. And I'm talking about that dry biscuit, the one that you damn near choke on at Popeyes. Except there's no butter flavor. There's no butter flavor packets. There's no Louisiana hot sauce to dip that thing in, man, in case that's what you do. That's what I do. And I love those biscuits and Louisiana hot sauce. Oh, my gosh. Trying to lower the intensity of it is what I'm saying here. You're going to get got. And that's exactly what happened to old Doofy over here, who was like, you know what me and my partners are going to go and do? We're going to roll up on this man, and we're going to try and put the pipe to him. And then when it all turned around, it was like, well, man, you know what really happened? I'm going to tell you what happened, Pimpin. You got into some muddy, murky, deep waters with a shark, and you weren't able to swim fast enough. That's all there is to that. If you choose to roll up on somebody, firstly, you probably better know who the hell you're dealing with. Secondly, understand you probably 9 times out of 10 don't know who you're dealing with, but you can find out real quick when you catch it. Because Nate Diaz ain't for the games. That is one thing I will say about him. If you want the drama, Nate's going to come for you, and he really doesn't give a damn. Because he is that guy. That's pretty plain and simple. As a matter of fact, I would say Nate Diaz is one of the legit street dudes in MMA. His fight record is not the greatest, and it's not going to indicate that he's anything special in that octagon. But I'm going to tell you something. If you don't want to see him on the street, then you don't want to see him on the street. Because he's not that dude to be played with. I'll tell you that much right now. That's pretty much all there is to it, isn't it? You see, the problem is we live in a society where a lot of people are comfortable sitting back, saying a bunch of things that they could never back up. That's the truth of it. They hide behind so many different things. I mean, doesn't anybody remember the Mike Tyson video? Had Mike Tyson really given that dude work on that airplane, Brody would have been eating out of a straw for the rest of his life. Just poking him, nagging him, you know, supposedly spitting water at him. Can I get an autograph? Why not? Tapping him, doing all this stuff. Mike's like, dude, leave me alone. Leave me alone. And it's not like you haven't seen Mike Tyson absolutely lose his on somebody, right? Because we all have. I mean, come on, man. After a championship fight, not only did Mike Tyson beat Brody in the ring, but then he went later on that night to a nightclub and kicked his ass again. That's the dude you're trying to make angry. Good luck with that, pimpin'. You got exactly what you deserve. Celebrities are not untouchable people. And celebrities are also not people who can go without touching somebody else. You think everything is going to be a lawsuit. Like that guy one time, Robin landed on him while he was diving for a ball. I'm going to sue you. What the hell? But that's the society that we've been trained to live in. It's really unfortunate. So there you have my two cents on that. Diaz not getting charged. Every right to defend himself, as you should have. Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer. Wherever you're listening, I am there. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online all day, every day on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Don't you dare touch that dial.
Block 50 Global Radio, the greatest in hip-hop and rap.
Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the program Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. If we tell you to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan, if you miss the show live. And, of course, I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online 24-7, 365 at zenofm.com/Block50 Global Radio. And of course, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram and TikTok is all Block 50 Global Radio as well. Quick little recap going on here. Again, the injuries are mounting in Colorado. Obviously, we'll be talking about them playing against USC a little bit later on in the week, probably Friday. I mean, after all, it is Wednesday. probably Friday, you know, because obviously tomorrow we've got NFL football to discuss. By the way, did you see the meme where the dude was like, they should move the Broncos-Bears game to Wednesday at 3 a.m.? Nobody's going to want to watch that atrocity. Although, not only am I a Broncos fan, but this is what I do. So, I'm going to have to just, we're all just going to have to eat crow on Monday night. Is what it is. man. We're like, Ryan Day can chill the hell out. I mean, come on. You've got 90-year-old Lou Holtz now calling Marcus Freeman apologizing, thinking that loss is his fault. Ryan Day's acting like he's going to see Lou Holtz on the yard or something. Where's Lou Holtz? I don't know, bro. At home, taking a nap. Your mama's. Chill out, man. He's like 90, bro. He's earned the right to say whatever the hell he wants to say. It's not that deep. You want to find somebody? You can find me. That's how you really feeling. Boy, the Pac-12... Again, the committee temporarily for the Pac-12, Oregon State, and I believe it was also Washington State, they were able to get a whole stop because the Pac-12 was going to meet to vote on whether or not the conference was going to stick together, right? Well, then that whole thing got changed, and they got a judge to put a stop to it because they basically said, look, we don't think it's okay for teams to vote that are not going to be here about whether or not the conference should dissolve, which is logical. It should be that way. I agree 100%. Now you've got the CFP committee, though. They're scrambling around going, what are we going to do about the college football playoff? Are we just going to take six teams? And by the way, they're still saying that they're going to have a best of, you know, the other five or whatever the hell they're calling it now. That's just stupid. Okay, we don't need what's going on right now. The best 12 teams should get in. That's the real reality of the situation. You don't need to worry about what the Pac-12 is going to do. Because inherently what you are deciding is, are we going to give an automatic bid to a Power 5 champion and just rank them out from there? That's what you're telling me. So if a conference champion is 10-3, and the loser of the conference championship game ends up being 12-1, you're going to mean to tell me that you're going to automatically let in that 10-3 football team over, let's say, Boise State, who goes undefeated? That's what you would rather have? Because if it goes down like that in a conference championship, then that should tell you one of two things. Either the team that was undefeated really wasn't that good to begin with and they got snuffed out, i.e. OU getting hornswoggled by Kansas State and then beat up again in the BCS championship game, okay? Or option B, the other team was just a matchup problem. But usually I prefer the aforementioned, which is overrated. Probably got lucky a couple times, again, a term I hate. Playing against teams that weren't as opportunistic as they should have been. Let's leave it at that. Top 25. Look, there's teams in there I don't agree with. Obviously, KU being one of them. I think that Ohio State, as good as their win was over Notre Dame, I still think it's a little high. I'd probably sit them at like number 9 or number 10, somewhere in that neighborhood. I like Penn State better than I like Ohio State right now. But I guess we're going to find out about them pretty quickly, right? So... that's kind of the way that whole thing is going to go. But obviously still very early in the season. A lot of football left to be played, all right? We're not even into October yet. So we're going to see how this all begins to work out. But for the time being, it kind of is what it is. I can say, though, unequivocally, for certain, I am not a fan of KU being ranked in the top 25. That's just the way that it is, okay? But then again, like I said, by the end of week 3, there were only 39 undefeated teams left in all Division I college football. Mind you, there's over 131. So damn near 100 of them had already suffered a loss. That's huge. You got to really think about that. All right? Again, the Deion effect is going into the transfer portal as well. Guys losing all their big-time players. You don't want them to go to Coach Prime, do you? So there's that. All right, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. The show is called Fired Up. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Simply take advice to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Guys, obviously tomorrow we're going to be taking a look at the NFL, some college football games as well. And of course, going into Friday, we'll be talking about the games from Thursday night. And of course, we'll be talking about more college football on Saturday as well as the NFL for Sunday. Guys, I am on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, Drew Duncan Radio. I am on TikTok and YouTube. Simply look for The Real Drew Duncan. That's R-L. Whoever spelled it the right way, bro, just let's swap. If you're out there listening, let's swap. We're going to pay some of these bills. Your local programming is coming up next. Don't you dare touch that dial.
Block 50 Global Radio.